Okay, so I'm a sort of a postprandial, before you get really deeply into your beers and after your lunch, depending on your time change, speaker. What I wanted to do today was really introduce a new research project and a new way of thinking about the global payment system. Try to spice it up a little bit. Now, I found this cartoon in the International Financial Law Review, which isn't necessarily where you might look for some kind of graphic interpretation. But it speaks to the issues related in particularly payments and payment settlement between Europe and the United States, and the importance of CHIPS, the Clearinghouse Interbank Payment System, which is something I'll be talking about shortly. Okay, so this project is about global correspondent banking from 1870 to 2000. And what I'm seeking to do is explore the plumbing of the global payment system. And that metaphor, I think, is really quite meaningful, or at least useful, that it's prone to leakage, that there's diversions through the pipes, that there are points of failure, and indeed that plumbers come along and try to patch up the system. So it's got all that kind of elements of fragility as well as elements of flow. It's something that's generated quite a lot of interest more recently, particularly since 2008, because there's been a decline in the volume of correspondent banking since 2008. So the volume of transactions and international payments, of course, hasn't really slowed down. But the number of correspondent banks and the number of banks that are engaged in the payment system globally has declined by about 25,000. And this is explained through new anti-money laundering, counter-terrorist funding, sanctions, the new kinds of controls on these payments that make it more expensive for banks to operate these sort of clearing systems and settlement systems. So the cost benefit of acting as a correspondent is changing. On the other side, there's other digital solutions. So I know we're having a panel at the end of today on central bank digital currency, but the cross-border solutions in the private sector are perhaps even more further advanced. There's a risk, however, of disintermediation in the payment system if some countries or some banks in some regions are excluded from it. It also might introduce new risks to regulatory oversight and financial exclusion of poorer countries. So the BIS or the FSB really has focused on the nature of the global payment system and its evolution and innovation as an important part of its program. And the BIS CPMI has been quite focused on that. As a historian, though, I'm really interested in how this system responded to financial crises in the past, to conflict, to technological innovation, to changing bank business models and the changing nature of what banks do. And so the aim of the project then is to develop the universe of correspondent banking relationships and to see how they respond to these historic changes and shocks between the period of 1870 to 2000. So just to show you here the decline in the number of correspondent banking relationships is not evenly distributed across the globe. So you have a big decline in South America, less in North America. And so Africa and South America are the largest, are the regions which are experiencing the largest retreat of banks from the correspondent banking system. And this is based on SWIFT data, which is the major messaging system. Okay, so kind of with that background, thinking about the literature and correspondent banking, it's relatively thin on the international perspective, but there's been a lot of great work, and I'm sure maybe you've even had it presented to you at previous conferences on the United States correspondent banking system, the internal system, and its reaction to the Great Depression and other kinds of financial shocks. And I have to say that I was really inspired by seeing Chris Michener at the Bank of England give his paper on with Das and Vossmeyer on the contraction and the flexing of the domestic correspondent relationships over the course of the Great Depression. The historical literature is on international correspondent banking is pretty thin. So there's a couple of pieces on London by Mullen and Mickey, who did sampled a couple of years to try to see what was happening. Similar sorts of things has been done by Merritt, Panza Merritt and Chan to look at how Australia plugged into the correspondent banking network, particularly in London. And Scott and Zacharias have written a history of the SWIFT system, which is the global messaging system that started in 1977. But their historical element is relatively limited. There's some contemporary interest in it, and particularly the potential for fraud and the difficulties of regulation. And then more recently, more literature on the current issues brought up by the IMF, by Grohlman and Ustra, and by the BIS, by Von Peter and Rice, and the CPMI and the BIS FSB work is ongoing, as I said. Okay, so what am I going to do, or what are we going to do? It's all going to come out of this big red Bible, which is called the Banker's Almanac and Yearbook, and that's an image of it on the left of your screen for 1978-79. You can't really tell in the image, but these are kind of huge red bricks that bankers would have sitting on their desks in order to look up how to send money to a small town in Botswana or wherever else. It has all the international banking connections, all the correspondent relationships for banks around the world, both in London and in New York. And on the right is the kind of a sample page from 1960. So blowing this up a little bit, this is the kind of data we have. And so this is a relatively minor Banco Popolare di Milano. And it gives a lot of really interesting information for each one of these thousands of banks. It gives you the list of London correspondents, and you can see that even a small bank like this one has a lot of correspondents, multiple correspondents in London, and multiple correspondents also in New York. And from these data, you can also get the size of the bank in terms of total assets and a range of other information. Okay, so that's what we're planning to do, but we haven't done it yet. The project started about 3 months ago, so we're in the process of collecting this data. But what it's going to give us, and maybe you also, is a completely granular database of all the correspondent, bilateral correspondent banking relationships in the world for every year between 1870 and 2000. So we'll be able to demonstrate those spatially and see the contraction on a global level and also on a regional level over this long period. Oops. Okay, so I'm leaping forward to the 1960s and 1970s, which is a period where I've kind of started to begin the research. It's a time that's really interesting for correspondent banking. It's the early 1960s. You have the Eurodollar market, the surge in global payments, the integration of cross-border interbank markets, partly because of this sort of huge surge of internationalization of banks in the late 1960s, from the mid-1960s really, into branches everywhere, into subsidiaries everywhere. This is the era of the great bank consortia trying to deal with and attract international customers. It's a time of really enhancing new market risks, particularly the advent of floating exchange rates that we've just been talking about. Nobody under the age of 60 had ever operated with floating exchange rates when they came in the early 1970s. So there's kind of a whole generation of difference there. And it introduces new market risks. It also introduces operational risks, particularly weak internal controls as banks internationalize very, very fast, and also the complexity that came from an increased financial innovation during this period, particularly in cross-border types of products and processes. In 1969-70, there's this paper crunch in over-the-counter securities as that market started to boom. And securities companies, particularly small securities companies, found themselves buried in paper and unable to process the number of transactions that they were struggling with. And indeed, 1/6 of U.S. of securities companies in New York went out of business in the aftermath as the market turned down. So there's this kind of operational risk of where the technology is not keeping up with the size of the market or the size of the business. So it's a really interesting time to look at how those correspondent banking relationships, how that global payment system coped with a big surge in activity. And just to give you an idea, these are sort of three ads in the Economist magazine for the Bank of California in 1968 that I thought were kind of cute. If the world is your market, let us carry your ball, or the ball rather. And these are named individuals from the Bank of California who are the correspondent banking managers. And they're bringing the world to the desk, to the oil field, indeed climbing onto the tractor of their clients in order to bring the world to them. And in this advertisement, they're boasting about having 2,000 correspondents around the world to service their customers' payments. Okay, so here we're seeing, I just need to move this down a little bit, the number of respondent banks for banks in London. And this is collected out of that Banker's Almanac for 1970 and 1975. So this is a relatively short period of time, but as I said, it's the end of Bretton Woods. It's a time of floating exchange rates. It's the oil crisis. It's the time of the huge expansion in international banking. In these years. And you do see a lot of change, but also a lot of diversity and a lot of variation. So you can see that Barclays Bank, for example, took on an extra 1,000 respondent banks between 1970 and 1975. So it had evidently a very aggressive strategy for moving very strongly into this business. This shows you the percentage change, so the relative change in the number of respondent banks for those from the graph that I've just shown you. And you can see that the Moscow Narodny, although smaller, made quite a large increase in the banks for which it was correspondent in London. And this kind of goes down. Now, Barclays isn't in this graph because it would have deflated all the others. And indeed, nor is Brown Shipley, which exited the market completely. So what I'm trying to convince you of, I guess, is that there's a bit of proof of concept here. There's a variation in strategy amongst the banks that are responding to these changes. In terms of the geographical reach, here we have changes between 1970 and 1981 in the number of territories where they had respondents. And you can see the dramatic increase for Barclays Bank, for example, and the continued increase into the 1980s. But something weird and wonderful is happening with the Bank of Scotland and the Royal Bank of Scotland. And the Bank of Scotland really entered its internationalization strategy a little bit late, but very, very aggressively. So that you can see that it's moving from maybe 50 or 55 countries in 1975. And 6 years later, it's in 150. It has respondents in 150. Similarly, you have a very different kind of strategy by Coutts & Co., which gets very excited at the end in the early 1970s. But after the crisis that I'm about to talk about in 1974, it contracts back down in its correspondent business. So again, it's proof of concept and looking for variation. And in order to get into this variation, we'll be going into the archives of these banks to look at what their strategies were, what the costs and benefits were, what they felt they were getting out of these relationships, in addition to the fees and deposits. Okay, I'm just having a bit of trouble going on. Okay, and again, just to kind of give you a sense of the spatial growth, not terribly sophisticatedly done, but this again is just between 1970 and 1975 for Barclays Bank's respondent reach. So in 1970, you can see they're in a lot of places. They're Africa, South America, it's a big international bank in the United States. But even in those 5 years, their reach into Africa, their reach into South America, and of course, the increase in their reach in the Gulf area is very clear. Okay, now looking at it from the American point of view in New York, it's a bit more difficult to get some information, but here's just some indications of what we have for banks in London that reported that they had New York correspondents and who they were. And you can see that that there's some dominance, particularly by Morgan Guarantee and Chase and manufacturers Hanover, Manihani. And then there's sort of a second tier, the Bankers Trust, the City Banks of this world, the Irving's Trust, and then a third tier of more minor representation. The banks that listed this in 1970 have had an average of about three correspondents in New York, but there's quite a broad range. So some only had one, and four or five banks in London had 11 separate correspondents in New York. So again, the question is, these relationships aren't costless to the respondent. Why would you have more than one? What are they getting from their different relationships? And again, there's a strategic question there. Okay, and this shows you again what that something really fun is happening in the 1970s. So this is the bank deposits of US banks due to foreign banks. This data was collected by the American banker, helped out by the Reserve Bank of New York from the call sheets of individual banks. And it's the kind of blue parts of these bars that were the demand deposits. So this is the demand deposits due to foreign banks, which they interpret as being the correspondent banking deposits of US banks in New York. And so you can see that they're pretty stable, not much happening, a little bit of an increase in 1970, but that by 1975, they've increased really dramatically, and that increase continues. This, of course, was a time of inflation, so we need to normalize it somehow. And what I've done here is you can see in this line on the right hand, with the right hand axis, the huge increase in foreign correspondent deposits as a proportion of domestic correspondent deposits. And you can see that that sort of doubles from about 10% to about 18 to 20% very sharply in the early 1970s. So there's something to explain here, and there's a big change happening in the correspondent banking business. Okay, so what was going on and how were these correspondent bank relationships settled? And this diagram shows you what might have happened before 1970, if Deutsche Bank was buying and settling sterling against dollars. So they'd send their telex to their New York correspondent and put their dollar deposit in. The New York correspondent, Morgan, would then take the telex, they'd read the telex, two people might read it, they'd get somebody to type up the check with the name of their other correspondents, they'd check the amount, they'd give it to a messenger, and the New York Clearinghouse then had international payments exchange five times every day. So they'd take the dollar check to the clearinghouse, which would credit Irving Trust, who would then notify Midland, Midland already having released the sterling. So it's quite a laborious type of relationship, and this is probably the simplest as it got. And what I'd really want to point out here is the payments exchange, that five times daily payment exchange happening at the New York Clearinghouse physically with paper. And it's this sort of paper settlement that's going to lead to the credit, to the paper crunch, if you like, for banking. So in 1970, you have the institution of the Clearinghouse Interbank Payment System. And this allows all day entries through computer terminals, with a final netting out at the end of the day. And then everybody has 30 minutes to meet any net deficit. And then there's a final payment through the Federal Reserve Bank of New York. So this innovation in 1970, it's demand driven. It's very clear that there's too many checks, there's too many messengers, there's too many clerks, and all the focus is on the last daily clearing in the hopes that you might have got your cover by then before you release your check. And there was a big investigation of the system by the Federal Reserve Bank of New York in July 1974 after a crisis. And you can see here that one New York bank had its payment staff drop from an average of 22 years in the bank to an average of 8 months within 2 years. So there's a clear kind of paper crunch, there's a clear labor supply problem, there's operational risk being introduced. And happily, there was a technological innovation available, the ICT solution, having a computer do it. And at the time, the clearinghouse was developing a computer system for its domestic correspondent relationships. And it adapted that into an international clearing. So it's driven and controlled and owned by the New York clearinghouse members, who then had associate members of the other banks in New York and their EDGECT subsidiaries. Okay, so here's a glamorous image of the Burroughs 3500, which was the computer that started off chips. You as a consumer of this computer would be following down this lovely red carpet to this super efficient looking woman at the end who is going to help you input. I imagine almost everybody here today understands the nature of what computing looked like in the 1960s and early 1970s. So you've got your tape machine, you've got your terminal, you've got your keying in and that sort of thing. So when it started in 1970, it's only the clearinghouse members that used the computer system. And there were about 15 of them. All the other 40 members of the clearinghouse of the CHIP system had to have their entries delivered in paper and then typed in and stored on these tapes and then printed out at the end of the day. I kind of love this 1970s technology. And even just looking at the advertisements, but also looking at the archives behind them, there's definitely a gender story to be talking about here and the labor force. And there's a gendered element to the technology and also to the clerical tasks as the evolution of the correspondent banking system took place over the course of the 19th and 20th centuries, which will be part of the project. Okay, so this is the growth in chips. It's a huge success and it's still going today, obviously. They started, as I said, in 1970 with only the clearinghouse members having access to the computers. They had to get a new computer almost immediately to get the other 40 members in. SWIFT, the international payment system, international messaging system rather, is introduced in 1977. In 1980, they had to have a moratorium on new members because their computer couldn't take them anymore, and it took them 3 years to open that back up. And then the number of members peaked around at about 140 before falling off. Not sure why they fell off. There's mergers and acquisitions during this period, which would have reduced the number of eligible banks. But it may also be that there's a longer term story that the FSB has realized in terms of the decline in the number of correspondent relationships and the geographic spread of that from before 2008. The average daily number of transactions goes up and up. It has little surges in financial crises, 1997, 2007, as we might expect. The value of settlements through the system increases again, similarly, and accounts for maybe 80-85% of US dollar settlement. But if you look at it in real terms, okay, it sort of seems to peak in the 1990s and then stops growing. So again, there's something to be explained here. Okay, so CHIPS had a lot of problems and this will be part of our understanding about the evolution of those plumbing solutions. The first of it is that the dollars were clearinghouse funds. So the foreign exchange payments that were coming out of the banks into European banks were immediately available, but the matching dollars were not available until the next day. And this was a problem identified in 1967. And then they talked about it, worried about it, and finally introduced a change in 1981. So part of the story of the changes in the adaptation of CHIPS and the regulatory response is a very slow responses to obstacles and wrinkles in the system, despite the huge surge in the activity. So if you were wanting to settle out a Friday, those funds wouldn't really be available until Monday. And this allowed the senders to have a strategic holding them over the weekend to put them into money markets. The other issue was daylight overdrafts. So the floats or the deposits only covered a very tiny proportion of turnover. And so it was essentially intraday credits. And we'll see how big those got. Another issue was the time change between New York, London, and Europe. So the New York clearing wasn't completed before the European banks closed. So the clearing went on till 4:30, but the actual settlement might not happen until 5:30 New York time, by which time London had been closed for maybe 4 hours and Europe for 5 hours. So as Crowley from the Reserve Bank of New York said, it's a business in which trust and confidence is absolutely essential because they're essentially extending credit to each other. And another problem was the computer capacity, which I've spoken of already. I wanted to show you the impact of same-day settlement, which was introduced in 1981 instead of next-day clearinghouse payments. So first of all, the data started to include the EDGE Act banks in 1981. So this is the American Banker recalibrated it. You can see the huge importance of EDGE Act banks once they were included in the correspondent banking deposits. But the next year, they'd started same-day settlement. And so the volume of those deposits more than halved. So this had a huge impact on the balance sheets of these banks, and indeed of banks in the United States more broadly. And this shows you the intraday trading credit. So the New York Fed did a survey in February 1989 to look every 15 minutes at what the total net credit positions were through the day. So 15 minutes into the day, they're already at 30 billion. There's a peak at 54 billion when Europe closes, and then a tailing off, and then it would have to come down to zero again by 5:15 or by 5:30. So there's a huge amount of intraday credit being offered through the system. It's not guaranteed as Fedwire is by the Fed. So there's fragility and risk in the system. And that risk is comes to fruition, I guess, in 1974 with the Herstatt Bank collapse. I'm presuming most of you will have heard about the Herstatt Bank collapse, fraud, insolvency. And the German authorities closed Herstatt before New York. And what this did is it exposed counterparty risk in the CHIPS system. So all the banks had typed in their payments into the CHIPS system, but they didn't release them. And so the head of the clearinghouse insisted that all payments be released. And in return, they allowed banks to come back the next day at 10 o'clock in the morning and retrieve any releases that they had made to European banks the next day if they didn't think they were going to get the US dollar cover. So it's an erosion of trust. It's a collapse in the trust, a sharp fall in the turnover, and a sharp and sustained fall in the average size of transaction. So I'll just finish here. I know I'm running out of time, but just to show you, this is the average size of payments. For each year. And here's what you're seeing, this big surge in activity, and then the Herstatt collapse, and the average value of transactions falls really dramatically. And then there's quite a steady recovery, but the nominal value does not recover until 1986, which I think is extraordinary. And indeed, if you look at it in real terms, it never recovers from the Herstatt shock. Okay, there's a range of other sorts of innovations. I've spoken about same-day settlement. In October 1984, you start to try to get bilateral intraday net credit limits, and then intraday net debit limits to try to reduce the counterparty risk. Okay, I've kind of come rather rushingly through. What I'm trying to convince you of is this is going to be an exciting project, that there's lots to explain, that the flexing of the system through periods of growth and contraction is going to be interesting. The strategies that the different banks are using in entering and leaving the payment system is going to be interesting. that looking how geopolitics is involved, how it reacts to changes in the direction and nature of international trade. I'm really getting excited about the technological innovation, as you can tell, both the ICT, but also complementary networks and bolts on. Obviously the role of financial crises, the bank strategies, the governance of the whole thing, the supranational as well as national regulation of these systems, external regulation versus self-regulation, and not only the global or transatlantic dynamics, but also the regional dynamics, I think are really going to be super interesting. So it's more of a case of watch this space rather than the results yet of this project. So thank you very much.
Thank you. So interesting. I have already got someone in the queue for a question, and that's Chris Meissner. If anyone else has a question, can you pop your name? Or not your name, because your name's on there, but just say question in the chat.
So I'll go ahead. So this is awesome, Catherine. Thanks so much for the presentation. I hope not just to watch the space, but maybe even be part of the space. As yeah. So there's probably a lot of people that know more than me about this. My questions would be, what's the substitutability or complementarity between an international branch and a correspondent? How are you going to track, like the Banker's Almanac gives you London and New York, but like these guys have correspondents all over the world, which the page from the Banker's Almanac didn't show it, but the map did. So it's going to be tricky. You got to go bank by bank. But a more substantive question, I'm really interested in Herstatt. I don't know enough about it, but like trust, it sounds fragile. What happened? Why didn't they, what did they do afterwards? How did they, resolve those issues of trust? Did they just go to in-house? And, is that why the interbank payments didn't recover? And I think that's a really interesting shock. But I wish I knew more about it. And I was begging for more on this short talk. So thanks a lot. That's great.
Do you want me to answer, Caroline, or do you want
yes.
me to? Right, okay, the branch correspondent thing is really cool. And this of course links really well into your project, Chris, that I know you're working on for the 19th century. I am interested in what the trade-off is. I'm also interested in why they have so many, or why they might have so few, because they would have to be keeping deposits, unremunerated deposits, in each of their correspondent banks. So there's issues there. I guess it would have to do with the expense, that it's a lot more expensive to set up a branch than it is to have a correspondent settle for you. So it may depend on the nature of your customer base and what it is that they're needing the correspondent for. How focused their trade is and this sort of thing. So that's my anticipation. We are collecting for London, New York, whether the foreign banks have a branch in London or New York. But I take your point that we're only getting the banks that have correspondents in London and New York. The project is going to eventually hire 6 postdoctoral researchers. We've got 2 on board already, and we've got Raphael Hein here, who I can see is attending here today, who's doing a DPhil. And so part of the project will also move into regional work packages. So we've got a Latin American, an East Asian work package as well, to be looking at those intra-regional relationships. So in fact, I'm starting with Canada, US, Cuba, and Mexico out of the Rand McNally, because you could map every single correspondent relationship for every city in those territories out of Rand McNally, if you have the patience. In Herstatt, I could go on and on, but maybe I'll come back to it.
Yeah. As moderator, I'm going to just take a point of privilege and say that with the Rand McNally, that Matt Jaremski has scanned loads of those, and we used it in the paper we just did on banking concentration, and there may be a relationship there between the banking concentration measures that we computed, but it's also Rand McNally is the source, and there's lots done with the scanning. The next person up is Will, and then Bob, Ellen, I don't know how to pronounce that, Alan, and Mike. Just so you know where you are coming up in the queue.
I'm just going to make a couple of sort of, you know, rest of the story type comments. I mean, the situation with Hellstadt risk did provoke a pretty severe regulatory backlash, first in the form of the Lamfalussy standard, which I think kicked in the early 90s, which required essentially some co-insurance in the form of collateral pool with CHIPS. And CHIPS did not like that arrangement very much. That resulted in, number one, redesign of CHIPS, and number two, initiation of what during the day is probably the world's largest single financial institution, which is the CLS Bank. And the amount of stuff that goes through the CLS Bank, if you haven't heard of it, is pretty mind-boggling. I remember the day after Bear Stearns, they throughput about 12 trillion in transactions. Very interesting institution if you haven't thought about it. It's not quite a central counterparty, but sort of, and very key. It is not clear that the problem has been entirely solved even today, but it was an issue that was, you know, very much in the minds of regulators after that 1974 incident. And I'll stop there.
Thank you. I'll look for CLS. I hadn't really got that far along. The other big reaction to Hellstadt, of course, was the Basel Committee. And particularly wanting to make sure that there was supervisory jurisdiction, or that all subsidiaries and international banks were being supervised by somebody. My take on that is that it was prompted maybe by Hellstadt, but they, as at their very first meeting, the chair of the committee said, we're not gonna have an early warning system. The Hellstadt is not going to be our model, essentially, and they moved to onto other crises, including the international Israel-British bank, rather.
My recollection is a lot of the small banks were kicked off after the Lamfalussy standards were off CHIPS de facto.
Yeah, well, that might then explain that kind of decline later on, 20 years later, for sure.
Since we are short on time, I just want to encourage maybe Bob, Ellen, and Mike to put out their questions, because the session ends at 2:10 technically, which is now-ish. So if you three could put out your questions in brief, then Catherine would be able to address them.
Well, maybe I'll say this is a 5-year project. It's a 2 million euro project. It's going to be going on, and you'll be hearing about it over the next little while. So
yeah,
part of my purpose in being here, I think, is to engage you in it. If you're interested right. in the data, if you're interested in collaboration and the approaches, I'm looking really to engage as many people as possible in it. So those who still have questions could either leave it in the chat or indeed email me, Alain, or Mike, or Paul.
Well, let's let them ask their questions. I'm not cutting you off now. I just wanted to alert people that we are virtually out of time and that three people here have questions, Bob, Alain, and Mike Bordeaux so far.
Okay. Bob, I think you're muted.
You're muted, Bob.
Okay, this will be super brief. It's a comment, but it's something, it's a sub-theme you need to keep in mind. In the summer of 74, Hellstadt wasn't the only bank that got in trouble. Franklin National got in trouble because its London branch was speculating in foreign exchange. It lost big, it was insolvent. It should have been closed just like Hellstadt, but Arthur Burns wouldn't let it be closed. And sure, there would have been a lot of disruption, but the point is that was really the start of central bank creation of moral hazard in a big way. So there's an issue here. Whenever you have a crisis, you want to bail out because there's going to be a lot of disruption. But the other side of that is moral hazard. And so summer of 74 is when, if you want to do a moral hazard story, that's when things really really begin to get big. Comment done.
Yeah, I've written quite a lot about the 74 crisis on the international scale and all the other banks. Lloyds Bank was a victim of rogue trading, for example. And you had a lot of banks in Germany, small banks in Germany, close to closing. And indeed, the German response was to set up the Lyco Bank, I think that's what it was called, Raphael, to kind of pool that risk a little bit. But thank you for the reminder.
Yeah, maybe just very briefly, I just wanted to know if it was more a story of new technology coming and banks following that, or you know, banks pushing to get new technology and helping build it because they needed to have like something new to transfer money.
I think it's sort of the latter. In that the volume of transactions increased so sharply, and the shock to their systems, their operational systems, was so fast that they moved to this technology. But then, in a sense, the computer technology is expensive, and it didn't keep up with the pace of change. But it's something I need to investigate more.
Right. Like my comment was follows from that, and you got two themes going on: economics. Okay, and you know, the whole story of how all these institutions are developing, and tech. Okay, so the thing is, there's obviously each side is driving each other, but you might want to think about that, about how to organize it, because these are the big forces that are underlying your story.
Absolutely, and it starts with the telegraph, right?
So it's you know.
Alain?
I think Alain has asked his question.
He did.
All done?
Yep.
Okay, that's it. Chris has his hand up again.
No, I think he's clapping.
You clapping? Sorry. Clapping. Yes, clapping.
Thank you very much.
Okay. Thanks, Catherine. And then a break.
Why don't we all take a break until about 2:20 East Coast time, 20 minutes after the hour then. And thank you all for a great session.
So Catherine, are you still there?
Yeah.
So you got that was the grant you were applying for 2 years ago.
It is.
Oh, it's great. So you got it. Good.
Yeah, I got it. It's going to be a lot of fun. It really is. But there's just so much to it. But we're trying to kind of tender for the data collection and everything, which is kind of the monster of it. So we're going to collect every 10 years and then every 5 years in between, and then try to increase the granularity. I keep hoping that technology, machine readable technology, will kind of speed up, and we won't have to do quite so much hand entry, but it's quite difficult to get around it because the sources are kind of complex.
But you got a whole team on this, right?
Yeah.
There's a whole, it's a Europe team, but it's.
Right. Yeah, so we're outsourcing the data collection to a data entry company. So we've scanned the relevant pages. So we just need to get that through the Oxford bureaucracy. And then I've got two people, Marco Molteni and Anna Elena Pivovarava, working on the data side of things to get the database going and the visualization and the network analysis. And then Thibault Guidet is going to come on as an archivist in July, not as an archivist, but doing some archival research. And then we'll bring on the Latin Americanist, somebody to do crises, and somebody to do Asia further down the line.
Wow, congratulations. I didn't know if you got the grant, because I wrote the letter, but I
Okay. Oh, I'm sorry. I feel like I'm running around broadcasting it to everybody I can think about.
So yeah, well, that's great.
I should have told you as well. So thanks for your support.
Okay.
Catherine, have you had contact with Bruce Summers?
No.
He was head of computer technology and payments at the Fed for many years. And for example, he set up the payment system in Poland and Russia. I'll send you his email. He would be a very useful resource for you. He teaches at VMI now, so he's still around.
Perfect. Yeah. That would be wonderful. Thank you.
Yeah, he's going to be a really good resource.
I mean, the banking crises and the sort of archival nature of strategic international banking regulation and stuff is more my bat. The technology is a bit of a new, novel kind of aspect to my work. So I'd certainly benefit from somebody who knows the nitty gritty.
Yeah, but the technology stuff looks really cool as well. I mean, it sounds an exciting part as well. Especially these pictures, I think they always make it much more interesting.
Yeah, well, and I did looking at the telegraph and the offices and how they represent their correspondent banking offices and adverts and stuff. There's always this army of women in the background doing the actual work. So I'm hoping that I'll have a DPhil student starting next year working on that aspect, which would be kind of fun, just as something completely different again for me.
Yeah, and there's a lot on gender and the image, right? I think that's always quite interesting to follow. Yeah, I think that some of the pictures I saw at the Bank of England are the same as well. So.
Mm. Well, there's Les Femmes qui Comptent. Do you know that?
No.
Sort of a French network, Les Femmes qui Comptent, and they had a Twitter feed and stuff where they looked at women working in banks. And
oh, cool.
Yeah, it was really cool. I don't know if they're still going or not.
I think they are. Hi. It's Laure Gonel-Curé and these people. Yeah, I think it's, or maybe they've ended the first cycle and then they're going on. Yeah, it's a very cool, very cool part of the project.
Oh, I see Thibault was here as well. Hi. So we should do some collaboration, Chris, with your project, Chris Meissner.
Yeah, we got to talk. We've been looking at correspondence in the past few weeks too, and we should try to combine or share or
communicate, yeah,
at least, so we know who has what. But only up to 1913, right? We're not going past World War I yet. So
the layout of the Banker's Almanac is quite different before 1920, so I've been trying to stay away from that so far. I'm looking at 1920 to 1980 at the moment.
The cleaning is, yeah, go ahead, Will.
So Catherine, what's happened was, you know, the CLS Bank came online in the early 2000s to kind of, the ambition was to completely do away with Herstatt. And it's very interesting if you read up on some of the BIS or regulatory stuff, participants of that have evolved something called the inside out swap. This is sort of central bank mumbo jumbo, but it's a way of kind of undoing the benefit of CLS and moving back more towards the original, CHIPS problem. So I will see if I can find something on that, but these things tend to go full circle. There was also a lengthy, I think, Federal Register post by Tim Geithner, or at least he had some testimony after Dodd-Frank was passed, you know, why FX markets do not need a central counterparty. So there was a lot of public, defense of the CLS system that appeared, I think, in the Federal Register. So it's not an issue that's gone away by any stretch of the imagination.
It'll be interesting to see if there were initiatives to try to overcome the problem in a similar sort of way that didn't get off the ground.
Well, CHIPS is still working. It's not a legal requirement that you settle, you know, through CLS. So CHIPS is still working. It just doesn't have quite the same role that it did before.